grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
My sisters in Christ, today is the 13th Sunday of ordinary time, and we are very conscious, of course, at this time, not only of our own needs here on this time of retreat, but especially for those in Australia, particularly the greater Sydney area, who are not able to worship with the Lord in the physical presence. So while we're thankful for our own opportunity, we are also mindful of those who cannot receive the sacraments at this time. And now let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Son of God, Son of God.
God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Death was not God's doing. He takes no pleasure in the extinction of the living. To be, for this he created all. The world's created things have health in them. In them no fatal poison can be found, and Hades holds no power on the earth, for virtue is undying. Yet God did make man imperishable. He made him in the image of his own nature. It was the devil's envy that brought death into the world, as those who are his partners will discover. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I
work of mercy to remember how generous the Lord Jesus was. He was rich, but he became poor for your sake, to make you rich out of his poverty. This does not mean that to give relief to others, you ought to make things difficult for yourselves. It is a question of balancing. What happened to be your surplus now against their present need? And one day, they may have something to spare that will supply your own need. That is how we strike a balance. As scripture says, the man who gathered much had more to much. The man who gathered little did not go short. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Jesus went with him, and a large crowd followed him. They were pressing all round him. Now there was a woman who had suffered from a hemorrhage for 12 years. After long and painful treatment under various doctors, she had spent all she had without being any the better for it. In fact, she was getting worse. She had heard about Jesus, and she came up behind him through the crowd and touched his cloak. "If I can touch even his clothes," she had told herself, "I shall be well again." And the source of the bleeding dried up instantly, and she felt in herself that she was cured of her complaint. Immediately aware that power had gone out from him, Jesus turned round in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" His disciples said to him, "You see how the crowd is pressing round you, and yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" But he continued to look all round to see who had done it. Then the woman came forward, frightened and trembling, because she knew what had happened to her. And she fell at his feet and told him the whole truth. "My daughter," he said, "your faith has restored you to health. Go in peace and be free from your complaint." While he was still speaking, some people arrived from the house of the synagogue official to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why put the master to any further trouble?" But Jesus had overheard this remark of theirs and said to the official, "Do not be afraid, only have faith." And he allowed no one to go with him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. So they came to the official's house, and Jesus noticed all the commotion, with people weeping and wailing unrestrainedly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and crying? The child is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. So he turned them all out, and taking with him the child's father and mother, and his own companions, he went into the place where the child lay. And taking the child by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I tell you to get up." The little girl got up at once and began to walk about, for she was 12 years old. At this, they were overcome with astonishment, and he ordered them strictly not to let anyone know about it, and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
St. Mark gives us two stories, both the woman and the child were 12 years of age. We don't know if there was any connection between them, but unlikely. However, there were both, obviously, the 12, so that the stories are brought together. Interestingly, in the beginning, the synagogue official is referred to as just that. And then St. Mark tells us this other story of the woman who is in with a hemorrhage and in a very bad way. But we look at the stories together. There's actually a short version of this gospel that leaves the middle story out completely. And I think it's actually an oversight to do that. Because on the one hand, Jesus responds readily to the synagogue official. But the synagogue official was an important person in the local community. And Jesus goes readily and willingly to cure his daughter. Meanwhile, though, this little woman who is not known by anybody, who would have been ritually unclean, so for her to come and touch Jesus, she would have made him unclean as well, because the bleeding would have made her ritually unclean, so she would have, in a sense, infected Jesus. We know that in our biological understanding that that's not the case, but the cultural understanding at that time, it was a very different story. And so the woman, obviously of great faith, believing in him, and Jesus allows her to be cured. Now Jesus is being pressed by the crowd. Let's try and imagine what's going on here. So he's being touched and probably moved or bumped here and there. I don't know about you, I think I would have gotten claustrophobic by that stage. But anyway, he stops now and he's looking around. Who touched me? And the disciples think it's just about a physical touch. But eventually he's looking around. Now, is it the question that Jesus doesn't know who actually touched him? Well, of course he knows who touched him, because he also knows that after the news about the little girl dying, he just says to the father must have been shocked by that stage. St. Mark mentions nothing about his reaction, but he obviously would have been shocked, and he immediately comes to reassure him, "Do not worry, only have faith. Only have faith." In other words, you don't know what's going to happen, but I do. So if Jesus, who knows what he's about to do and what is about to happen to this little girl, if he knows the future there, does he also not know who touched him? Of course he does. So why does he persist with it? Because he wants to bring out the example of this little woman. There's another little sub-theme that's going on here about who is it that can ask Jesus for a favor. Is it just the important people in the society? Or is it anybody who has faith? And that's one of the reasons I believe St. Mark tells us these two stories together, that Jesus readily goes out of his way to assist a synagogue official who also, by the way, had faith. But he doesn't want to let this woman's great faith go unnoticed just because she is not known in the community. So what ends up being the ultimate criterion for Christ and valuing and people and seeing what their goodness is not their social importance or their social standing, but rather the depth of their faith. And so he waits then until the woman eventually owns up to it. And notice Jesus could have pointed her out, but in so doing, he would have embarrassed her. But the way he allowed it to happen, by waiting, it's a bit like a teacher in a classroom and there's three or four children talking, but the teacher is writing on the blackboard, so he can't quite work out who it is. But then, you know, turns around and the teacher's looking and says, "Who is it?" "I'm waiting until you own up." And the sheer silence then makes them come forward and they, "Okay, you three stand in the corner," you know. Now this woman is not in trouble. Something good has happened here, but Jesus wants to bring it out. And she comes forth, you know, fearful and worried that maybe something has happened that's wrong, but of course it's not that at all. It's the kind of fear that we also see in other parts of the gospel whenever they're in the contact with the divine presence. Mary receives the annunciation from the angel, the archangel. After the archangel speaks, she starts to feel fear. Zechariah experiences something. He also experiences fear in the sanctuary. So too this woman, she is in fact fearful. But she tells him, so Jesus wants to bring this out into the open, and we don't know how many actually caught on to the discussion, but certainly those immediately around him would have indeed heard everything. And later on, how do you think this story came around? Well, the woman herself, no doubt, would have been a Christian by that stage or shortly thereafter. And in the early church, she would have been a devout Christian, and she would have told that story, shared her experience. We only get a very summarized version of it here in the gospel. And then we continue. Jesus is on his mission. So Jesus is on the mission. He has a detour, cures this woman, and then continues. It is now the man, the synagogue official, is referred to as the synagogue official until they get into the town. But, so they came to the official's house, and Jesus noticed all the commotion. Why all this commotion and crying? The child is not dead, but asleep. They laughed at him. He turned them all out, taking with him now the child's father and mother. Notice, the synagogue official is no longer called the synagogue official. He's simply known as the father of this child. There's something significant there. There's no longer any titles involved. It's the father and the mother. St. Mark could have easily told us, you know. So he took with him the synagogue official and the mother and went to see the child. And that would have been consistent. But there's a shift here in terminology, and there's something significant going on here. That ultimately, it's not because of his title that he is invited in, but rather because of his faith. And clearly, when Jesus said to him, just have faith, do not worry, do not be afraid, only have faith, the man must have believed. Because if he didn't believe any longer, Jesus would have challenged him. Remember, Jesus only works miracles whenever there is sufficient faith for him to work that miracle. Even though it may not be a perfect faith, it may not be the faith of the centurion that we heard just a couple of days ago, or yesterday actually, but it's got to be faith. And then he cures the child, and not cures the child, he revives the child, and the child walks around. A curious thing then happens. He says to them, they were overcome with astonishment, and he ordered them strictly, do not let anyone know about this, and told them to give her something to eat. What does he mean by saying that? Everybody outside, the mourners and the musicians, there was a custom in those days, they all thought she was dead. She comes back out, eventually they're going to see the child. So how is it possible that they could actually keep the secret of Jesus? What is he exactly saying to them? Oh, don't tell them that she's now risen from the dead. Or is it something else? Well, they can try and hide it, but in fact, the local community is going to know that something extraordinary has happened. Either the people outside who had laughed at Jesus are going to say, oh gosh, you know, we may have been mistaken here. She's obviously well. Or some of them are going to say, you know what, she was definitely dead. And they're going to later interrogate the mother and father and say, what happened? So eventually the story comes out. Otherwise, how does St. Mark find about it? Who told St. Mark about this story? Well, I would suggest either Peter, James, and John, or the parents themselves of this little girl, or perhaps the little girl herself. So what's going on when Jesus is saying to them, do not tell others about it? Well, perhaps he is saying, you know, try not to trumpet it so much. But the hidden message is, try and keep the kingdom of God hidden. You cannot. The kingdom of God is like the bright sun shining. And once somebody tastes the real power of God at work here, go knock yourself out trying to deny it. And the devil, in fact, with his jealousy, is constantly trying to explain the works of God, trying to dismiss them as not really being powerful signs. But eventually, the devil himself has to give up because he realizes he cannot trick human beings forever. So I think this is what's actually going on underneath that question that Jesus often says, don't tell anyone about it. The man who was born blind and is cured, don't tell anyone about it. Okay, even if I didn't tell anyone about it, sooner or later someone's going to discover that I don't need a stick anymore now to get there. They're going to realize I can see again. They're going to ask me, how did you see? Look, I'm sorry, I can't tell you, or I'll have to kill you if I do, you know? So, in other words, it's about the mystery of the kingdom. Now, the mystery of the kingdom is also at work in us. The work in us. And while on the one hand, we are meant to be discreet about the gifts and the favors that God gives to us, they're meant primarily for ourselves. But the fact that Christ has worked powerfully in our lives is not meant to remain with us. It's meant to be the very fire or the very experience that produces a fire within us to want to tell others about him and to evangelize them in his name, so that by having a relationship with him, they too can experience something of the beauty that we have experienced, something of the beauty that Jairus, the synagogue official, and his mother experienced with the raising of their daughter, something about that woman who to this day remains without a name, but we will know eventually in heaven that she also experienced and told the story of the glory of the Lord in her life. us stand now to profess our faith using the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, who was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. My dear sisters in Christ, as members of God's family, having listened to the word of Jesus, let us now entrust our prayers to the Heavenly Father. We pray for the church throughout the world, especially Pope Francis and Brian, our bishop, and all bishops and clergy everywhere, that the church may be protected, that she may increase in numbers, that she may constantly evangelize all the nations. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all our civic leaders, especially here in Australia, at all levels of government. Grant them wisdom and courage. Grant them insight to truly serve the people of Australia and to protect the citizens and all the members and their dignity. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who are unemployed at this time, those who are experiencing financial hardship, that the Lord may grant them the grace of trust and that material assistance may come to them. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the respect of every human person from conception until natural death, that by valuing the dignity of every human being, the image of God may constantly be recognized and that openness to faith may be ever present. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all our families, our benefactors, those who have asked for our prayers, that we may accompany them spiritually, that we may constantly beg God for grace for their situation. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for each one of us as we continue on this time of retreat, that we may open to God's offer of love ever more generously, that we may be freed from those things within us that cause us to stumble, to not receive the gift of love as God gives it to us. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for what else shall we pray?
Lord,
hear our prayer. Almighty and ever-living God, your Son has taught us to call you Father by that most intimate and familiar name. Grant what we ask of you in faith, not only these prayers that we make out loud, but those that are still buried in the depths of our hearts. And we ask these prayers through the same Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God.
Pray, my sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice and justice for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of his holy Church.
O God, who graciously accomplish the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray, that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The fifth preface of Sundays in ordinary time and the third Eucharistic prayer. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Heaven and earth are full.
rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. His wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Paul and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, at advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth. With your servant Francis, our Pope, and Brian, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a verbal sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away
the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. For those who will be participating in this Mass through online, now is the moment to make an act of spiritual communion. us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, we pray, so that, bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Not being in a parish, I have no announcements to make, but normally in a parish I'm always making announcements, so nothing anyway needs to be announced. Nothing at the moment, great. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May Almighty God always keep you, keep every adversity far from you, and in his kindness pour out upon you the gifts of his blessing.
Amen.
Amen. May God keep your hearts attentive to his words, that they may be filled with everlasting gladness.
Amen. Amen.
And so may you always understand what is good and right, and be found ever hastening along in the path of God's commands, make co-heirs with the citizens of heaven.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.